of you guys know her. Bella introduced you to my friend Lara, my bestie. Lara is, well, tell me a little about your family, Lara.
Okay.
Because some of them are here.
Yes, if you saw the three of Dwarves children in the back, they were my, they're, no, they weren't, they were. Yeah, Daniel's my oldest. Very well behaved, young, dapper Jen.
I'm dapper?
Yeah. Yeah, those are my three youngest kids, if you saw them. And I have two older girls.
The older one looks like your age, even though she's 14, because she's taller than her.
Yeah, she's 5'8". Oh, just got her braces off. I know. I don't look old enough to have a 14-year-old. I also cut off all my hair, so forgot about that. So I have a 14-year-old, a 12-year-old, 10-year-old, 8-year-old, and 5-year-old. And we have no self-control, so that's what it sounds like. We don't know when to stop bringing children into our home.
A lot of kids.
Yes.
So today's topic is about comparison over contentment.
Nope.
Contentment over comparison.
Yeah.
Wow. That would be bad.
How to compare more and be less content.
Yes.
That's the goal.
And a big part of it is jealousy. So just to get it started, tell me the story about when you were jealous.
Okay, so I think of a season in my life where I really struggled with jealousy and envy. When I was just a wee college student myself, I got pregnant. It was an unexpected pregnancy. And my husband and I were not married, and so it was a very challenging time. We ended up getting married 5 weeks before our daughter arrived. So we had this brand new family. I had a new husband and a baby, and I was still in college, and we moved back out to Philadelphia where we had met and went to school. And it was this really wealthy area, mainline Pennsylvania, and there's all these people there that live in mansions, and they're super educated and just very highbrow folks. And here I was feeling a little trashy. And so we moved out there and we found this awesome apartment. Not at all. It was a horse barn that was converted to an apartment that was had mold in it. That did
healthy
not,
for the baby, right?
Yeah, healthy for the baby and definitely good for my self-esteem to feel less trashy. So it was just a low point where I was surrounded by all this abundance and wealth and people who seemed they had it all together, and I'm had my little ragamuffin family in my ragamuffin apartment that we could barely afford this $500 a month rent that I had to clean for our landlord to get a reduced rent. I mean, we were in a rough spot. And so I tried to connect with other moms. They were all older than me and had their stuff together. And the big topic of conversation all the time was the addition they were putting on their house or their renovations. And all I'm thinking is where you can put your fancy tile? I was so resentful, and I really struggled with jealousy and envy because their big complaints in life were the appliances I want are on back order and the tile's not come in yet, and all I'm thinking is do you have mold? I don't want to hear about your little rich people problems. And I was feeling a little violent, a little ragey during that season.
And now you own a mansion.
Yeah, totally. Lots of fancy tile. Just kidding. But we are rich in love.
Rich in love. And you clearly conquered jealousy at this stage of life.
Oh yeah, do I seem like I'm not aware?
How did you get into this topic then?
Well, because I clearly struggle. I studied this topic actually for 2 years. I studied health and habits and discipline for about 3 years. And as I was studying that topic for a few years, I realized that part of that drive to study health, happiness, disciplines, and how to change your behavior, I realized that a lot of the drive behind the desire to learn about those things was really this lack of contentment in my life. And I have such a great life. And so why am I not content? What am I struggling with? And as I kind of dug through the layers of discontentment, I realized that the root of that was this comparison trap that we all get stuck in. I think that transcends gender. I think it transcends age. I think it transcends our spiritual sort of depth. I think we all can get caught up in that comparison trap. And so for me, I realized I spent 3 years studying like health habits and happiness, only to discover the root was jealousy, envy, comparison, and discontent. And so I shifted over. So it's been a 5-year journey. So yeah, that's how I.
You're only 20, so that's a lot of
years. And as a 20, yes. Young 20, yeah, yeah. Whippersnapper. I started as a fetus.
So,
started studying.
You gave a talk at our church to, like, what, 400 women on this topic. Mm-hmm. And you touched on a couple different things, like 4 things in particular. I just want us to go through them a bit.
Mm-hmm.
So the first question is, like, why is this so important to look at and to investigate?
Well, I mean, I think it, you know, as I mentioned, like you can study a kind of an area of struggle, and oftentimes it comes back to this particular root. I think that when people go into counseling, there are some common denominators, and one of those big common denominators is discontentment. It wreaks havoc on marriages, on your like professional life, your friendships, your romantic relationships. All of those interpersonal connections really suffer when you are feeling discontent, because oftentimes when you ask someone, do you like your life? Do you have a good life? Are you happy? People almost defensively are like, I'm happy. It's like, I have a good life. I'm happy. And it's like, why is your face doing that? And like, why are you kind of miserable in your life? But when you ask people, would you want to be happier? Everyone says yes. So there is this like kind of common root struggle of discontentment, and I think the root, we'll get to the true root of that, but I think comparison and jealousy and envy is like that first layer beneath discontentment, oftentimes.
Yeah. So before we get into like the typical jealousy we think of, talk a little bit about God's jealousy, because it's in the Bible, so you hear that. And it's like, okay, is jealousy all right?
Yeah.
What are your thoughts on that?
Yeah, so in the Old Testament, especially like in Genesis and Exodus, there's like 6 or 7 verses that will say that God is a jealous God. Exodus 34:14 is an example.
And that says, do not worship any other god. The Lord, whose name is jealous, is a jealous God.
Yeah, so it doesn't just say God is a jealous God. It says his name is jealous. And to me, that is a sign that is like so deeply rooted in his character that we should pay attention to what it means to be jealous like God. There are actually three Hebrew words that are translated into English as jealous, but they mean very different things. So there's kana, which is the jealousy that is described in those verses in Exodus about God being a jealous God. That's kana. And that's translated as jealous, but it means a very different thing than kina and kana, which are the human forms of jealousy. So that godly form of jealousy should be a goal. Because I think if it says his name is jealous, I think then we should also be jealous in the way that God is. And so I think we should take a little time just to unpack what that looks like. The word kana is used explicitly to almost exclusively to describe this type of grievous jealousy, this protective grief that God has over our hearts wandering away from him. So basically, if we go back to the very beginning, why did God create us? He created us to worship him. And he's really good at his job, and so we are really good at worshiping. All the time, every waking moment, we are worshiping something. And God becomes jealous when our time and our attention and our affections and our money and our talents and all of those things are being kind of deceptively lured away from God toward something in this world that sort of promises more than it can deliver. So our hearts can very easily be lured toward various temptations, various things in this world, money, sex, relationships, you know, you name it. You guys know about sin. So that's kind of, our hearts can very easily be sort of lured away from God. And when that happens, like a parent who sees their child wandering away, God becomes very like grievously, protectively jealous and envious. not envious, jealous. That doesn't, that actually doesn't translate to envy in any form, I don't think. Scratch that. Always, it's always jealous. So that's kind of what is, we are basically made to worship. And so when God becomes jealous, it's like this vigilant guarding over our purity, over our hearts being directed back towards God. And so, you know, kind of an example, I think that is an applicable in a human relationship would be in a marriage. If somebody were like luring a spouse away or enticing them, it is all kinds of biblical to be jealous for your spouse. To be like crazy jealous, like when you're dating, and be controlling and hyper-protective and paranoid, that's gross and immature. Don't be like that. But in the context of a marriage, like if I saw a lady all, you know, with my husband and I wasn't bothered by it, I've got some other problems. So I think that like there's an appropriate sense of a protective, kind of a vigilant guarding over the heart of the people around you. And I think, so that's the goal, that's where we wanna start, is the goal is to be jealous like God. So that means that like for you guys, as followers of Christ, we should be jealous for each other's hearts, not of each other's stuff. You know, we should be jealous for each other's diligence, not of each other's talents, not of each other's status, not of each other's giftedness. We should be jealous for each other to be like steadfast in this like walk of looking more like God, like directing our worship back to Him.
I like it. So we just talked about jealousy, what it should look like, but a lot of times it doesn't look that way.
Well, yeah, rarely does it look like we're...
Rarely.
I'm just being biblically jealous. That's all.
So I'm looking for it.
Yeah.
So how
yeah.
do we be on guard for the...
Like the sinful.
Sinful.
Yes. Yeah, so the... I think, like, it's shown... My favorite, like, story that shows jealousy, that the Kina and the Kana version of jealousy is Joseph in the Bible, right? So kind of just a brief overview of Joseph is he had many, many brothers, but he was kind of the favorite. Like, his dad very clearly was like, this one is my favorite, gonna buy him a fly jacket. And just like pick him to be my fave. So Joseph knows this. The brothers know it. He's not humble about it. He's very like my coach, dad, like kind of boasty and like braggy, and he kind of puts it in their face. And we all have bad siblings, right? You are not bad siblings. We all have had bad sibling moments, right? Joseph might trump all of our sibling moments, because as Joseph kind of boasts a little bit and makes it real clear that he is his father's favorite, his brothers, classic overreaction, throw him into a well, sell him into slavery. So, like, making our siblings all look way more normal, I think. I actually had this flashback moment of my sister. I used to have, like, these awesome curly bangs that I would feather.
80s.
80s. 80s, guys. Yeah, it was awesome. It was super hot. Try not to be jealous in the moment. You know, this is hard for you. But so my older sister had no bangs. She had long, straight hair, and she would always wear this like headband that she'd go like this, and then she'd pop it forward so she'd have like the poof.
Yes.
Yeah, nobody, you guys are all like young. You don't know what I'm talking about, but it was so cute. And I had these like awesome, this situation, because my mom didn't know how to like navigate curly hair. And so I just was like brushing it and getting more Mufasa-like every day. And I'm like, don't wear a brush through curly hair. If you ever have curly haired children, don't do that. Scrunch in some product. Sorry, but this is practical application in case. Okay. So, long story short, I decided to grow out my bangs, and I went to school and I did this. Okay? It was so fly. And I remember this little girl that we used to walk her to school, when I walked up, she goes, "Hi, Bethann," which is my sister's name. And I was like, yes, she thinks I'm Bethlehem. Because Bethlehem was the coolest because she had the thing. And my sister was like, she thinks you're me. And she was like so mad that I was taking this thing. And I had this moment where she felt like I was like infringing on her style. And I had this moment today, it was like, if we let jealousy stop us, I would still, at some point, like, you have to move forward, right? You would, because otherwise you just stay and you're like afraid and you're doing this comparison thing. But if I had let her jealousy stop me, I never, what did she want me to never grow out my bangs? I just think that would have affected like the kingdom. Because I would never ever speak to anyone or share the gospel ever. Because it would be hideous. Anyways, all that to say, we have these jealous siblings, and it's not as bad as Joseph's. But Joseph has this long history of jealousy between the siblings. So if we move forward in the story of Joseph, he, yes, he was thrown in the well, sold into slavery. He had some rough moments in prison and all these different things. But God really brought him into this place where he was going to really shine, which we'll get into later. But that's kind of the backdrop of a story in the Bible where you see these sinful types of jealousy, the Kenah and the Kana. But to me, when I hear that story, it's like, okay, they were jealous of his jacket. Like, why is that? Why did that story make it into the Bible? Because it seems so petty. But that's what jealousy is. Is sometimes it's so petty. Like, I like her shoes. I wish she was dead. So petty. I know that sounds dramatic, but I mean, you guys, if you had heard these people talking about the tile, there were some violent thoughts. So I think we've all had that. It's like, oh, they're, man, he's got it all, right? He's smart, and he's, like, savvy, and all the girls think he's great, and he can sing, and you hate him. Right? Yes.
So, about how he's, like, jealous about the jacket, wouldn't it be, like, about, like, how the father loves the kid so much, too?
Yeah, well, and that's kind of where I'm going with this. It's like, no, you're fine. That's a good question. I think there's like this petty element that they show in scripture. I think that's in there so that are reminded that that petty thing, it might seem really small, but it's representative, or it represents this like deeper, much bigger issue. And that's of like this sense of favoritism and feeling rejected. And so like it can be this big, heinous thing, right? Of reject these deep rejections and these deep wounds, and that is like sometimes so big that we don't want to admit it, right? Because it's really painful and maybe embarrassing to be like, oh, my dad doesn't love me as much, and so I hate my brother. Like that's really deep and heavy, and so we kind of leave it alone. We don't want to admit it, or it's so petty, like I don't like I want his jacket, that we definitely don't talk about it. Because it seems so small that we look small if we admit to it, and so we ignore that too. And so whether it's these small things we compare or these really big things we compare, whether it's bangs or rejection, those things develop really deep roots of sin in our life. And so I think that's kind of important to just be aware of it. It can seem small, but in actually one of the verses in Genesis 37, 1 through 11, yeah, I'll just quick find it, but it says, his brother said to him, do you intend to reign over us? Will you actually rule us? And they hated him all the more because of his dream. So he had this dream that he was going to be big and bad, and they hated him for it. So it talks about the hatefulness in there, and it says, when his brothers saw that their father loved him more than any of them, they hated him and could not speak a kind word to him. And that's what happens. Jealousy and envy is actually a sin of hatefulness. And have you ever found someone that you were like, I cannot compliment them, I cannot encourage them, I will not say a positive word? That's that hatefulness. That's the root of that is jealousy and envy. It's like it affects how we talk to each other. It affects our willingness or our unwillingness to encourage and build up our brothers and sisters. And it is actually a form of hate, I think.
Why don't you talk about these three types of sinful jealousy?
Okay, yeah, so there's that kina and that kana, they look in a few different ways. I think the most common is just envy. And you guys know, we are all inundated with images on social media or in person. You just see these little snapshots of people's lives, and people frame things really nicely. I mean, you have like the Pinterest board and the Instagram account. Everything looks great. No one's posting pictures of their like that they're a hoarder. You know, like you don't know that. You just see like, oh, they look good. They look cute, or they, oh wow, this guy really is all together. Or, how impressive! Look at the, all these accomplishments and achievements. And so we start to compare to just those images. But the, like the deeper, more compelling story there is that there's kind of things happening behind the surface, but we only see these, the kind of the highlight reel, so to speak. And envy is just when you are feel like a general unhappiness at other people's blessings, which is really embarrassing to admit. You're like, oh, you got a new haircut. Great. Glad things are going so well. Why do we feel unhappy when other people shine? There's something in us that feels like it just kind of bumps up against something in us. Mm-hmm. So the first one is envy. The second one is covetousness. It's just coveting just means desiring to have that which belongs to someone else. And a lot of times, I've found, at least for me, a lot of times we desire to have something that we didn't even know we wanted until someone else had it. It's like, oh, I see you bought my car that I didn't know I had or wanted or needed until you bought it, and now I can't believe you bought my car. It's like, you got a cool car, now I need that car, you know? Something, when we see somebody attain something or have a skill or a gift, we're like, oh, I want, that should be mine. And so that's coveting. And then the last one is, it's called Schadenfreude. This is not directly from the Bible, but it does describe the sort of phenomenon we see in the Bible. It's a German word, and it's, the direct translation is damaged joy. Which to me is really sad. I cry every time I talk about this, because I feel like it's a really sad place to be in your life, to delight in the misfortune of others. You have to be so disconnected from the understanding of your worth in God's eyes to feel so low and so small about yourself that you delight when other people are enduring destruction or pain. And so to me, that's like, it's a really deplorable type of sin problem, is to find delight in other people's misfortune. It feels almost like a sickness, truly. And I think it is. I think it's a soul sickness. When we stop worshiping God, which is what we were intended to do. We were created for that reason. And we worship anything other than Him, there is a gap. There is this God-sized hole in us that we are trying to fill with the next cute outfit or the next like album to drop or the next achievement or the best grade or the most recognition or the most stuff or whatever it is. The more we chase those things, the less fulfilled we are, the more discontent we are. And as we chase down these things that are empty and superficial, we become like this, this vast, gaping hole just sits there. And you're so disconnected from your worth that you kind of, that we get really small in our minds and we get petty, and we do get to a point, if that root gets deep enough, where we will delight or find joy in somebody else's damage. And to me, that's like, it's sad because it's like an awful thing to for other people, but it's sad because it's such a disconnect between your creator and who you really are. So that is why it makes me cry every time.
Different ways of being jealous or envious. So I mean, like, it's gonna happen to all of us. It has happened to all of us. It'll continue to happen to all of us. What do we do when it starts to creep in? As it continues to breathe.
Yeah. So the reality is, like, yeah, we can talk all day about how it's sinful, and it is, and it's very serious, and we should take it seriously, but also, it is going to pop up, and I really feel like we should not waste the opportunity. when envy pops up, we don't want to waste the opportunity to learn from it. I think that jealousy and envy is like an indicator light on a dashboard. When things get low in your car, when you're driving, like when something's not working correctly, like an indicator light pops up. Jealousy and envy are actually a very good indicator of what our heart is longing for and what our heart desires. And so I think when it pops up, I don't think you can break that sin cycle of comparison if you ignore it or stuff it. I think you have to really dig into, okay, I see this is creeping into my life again. I'm comparing myself to this person. What's happening here? Because that's an indicator of something that my heart desires is, what is it? And so I think of like, there's a few questions you can ask, but we always have to remember that with any sin struggle, with any sin pattern, it's like our, we will never come to a place where we've arrived and it's over. I think of it as like the people, I call them a people mover. What's it really called?
I don't know, like those cool moving walkways.
Yeah.
I call them like people movers.
Okay. Yeah, people mover, yeah. Okay, so those like, yeah, the moving walkway. That's kind of what our sin nature is like. Our sin nature will always be moving toward sin, always. Like since just when sin entered the world, at the beginning of time, we have now this sin nature that is always driven towards sin. And so if we're passive, if we're not doing anything about it, it'll always move in that direction. So if we're not actively fighting against jealousy and envy, we're going to arrive there at some point. And so I think once we get there, what is it indicating? What are we low on, or what do we need to rework? And I think there's three questions, or four questions really, that we can ask when that pops up. So the first thing is, what is it that I really want? I think we can all think of a time where we're maybe a person we feel jealous of, or a time that we feel jealous. And like in that moment, saying, what do I really want? So I'm seeing, for me, one thing I have struggled with is seeing other writers and speakers kind of just like beating down doors to get themselves to grow their career. And I'm like, really, A, not working very hard. B, I don't really want to do all those sacrifices, but like I'm just like, look at it, they're doing all the things. And it would make me feel jealous. And then I was like, wait, what do I really want? Do I really want that path? Because I don't. I'm not that ambitious. I don't really want to do that, honestly. I would like to someday, but right now I've got 5 kids at home, so much laundry, I'm exhausted, I don't really want to work as hard as other people are working to get there. So I had to stop and think, like, what is it that I really want? And do I want that path? And I realized, I don't want that path. What I really want is to be home with my kids and then really pour into this career path when it's the right time for me. So then I'm like, okay, so what do I really want? I want this thing that I already have. Why would I waste time being jealous then? And then the second thing is like, you might find that you do want that. I'm going to use an example of a career path because you guys are all in college. Eventually, you'll all kind of select a career path, and it's competitive, and you're going to want to get ahead and do the whole thing. So there, you see someone like getting ahead in their job, and you think, well, I want that. So, and maybe you actually do want that. So it makes sense that you would be jealous. So then you say, okay, so what is it that I really want? And then you say, no, I actually do want that thing. Once you've ruled in that you want that, then you say, okay, well, what does it take to get there? What's the price tag? Well, no, first, is it godly to want that? Do I just want the cute shoes? And is that godly to, like, pursue?
Obsess.
Maybe. To obsess, yeah. Or do I want, like, just financial freedom, so I can buy shoes if I need them. Like, that's a godly desire. That's a godly pursuit. Just wanting the shoes so that you can, like, look fly on Instagram? Not. Do people say fly? Because I've said it, like, 4 times. Is this out?
You do it.
What do you say? What do you guys say? Dope? What?
Dope.
Dope. Okay.
I learned that. Cool.
Dope. Okay. So do you just want the dope shoes so you feel dope? Are you overusing it? All right.
I went in too strong. I got excited.
Okay. Sorry. Okay. So, like, the question is, like, what do you really want? Is it a godly desire? So if the answer to those two questions is, like, yes, I do really want this, it is a godly desire, then what is the price tag? So, like, are you willing to pay the price? Because you're going to have to sacrifice. You're going to have to work hard. You're going to have to give certain things up. If, are you willing to pay the price tag? If you're not, that's okay. Then don't be jealous about it. So, for me, it's like I go into people's houses, and their houses are super clean. And I'm like, I'm going to live like that. From now on, I'm going to live like these people who are orderly. And then I go home, and I'm like, no, I'm not going to live like that. There are too many people here. I will live like that when I'm 100 and they're all finally out of my house. Then I will be tidy. But until then, it's just not happening. So I have to release it because I'm not willing to pay the price tag of being enslaved to the cleanliness of my home. I'm just going to, like, have real low standards. So I'm just going to, like, as long as no one comes and removes the children from the home, it's clean enough. I'm happy. And so we have to figure out, like, are you willing to pay the price tag? If you're not, then why envy it? Because now I look at people's clean houses and I'm like, I don't envy that. Mm-hmm. I do not envy the work you had to do to keep it Pinterest ready. Or whatever. Yeah. Instagram ready. I'm getting more and more elderly as I speak. So so I think those are some questions to ask. Are you, so what is it that you want? Is it a godly desire? What's the price tag? And are you really willing to pay it? And so sometimes you don't want to pay the price tag, but you should because it is a godly thing to pursue. Like I had to check myself on that. I'm like, maybe a little order would be probably biblical to pursue in my life. And so sometimes you have to just pay the price tag that you don't want to pay. So those are some questions though to evaluate when that indicator light sort of pops up.
Nice. Very nice.
These two are just little things.
Do you want address privately?
Yeah, that's totally. Okay, so two things during this couple year process of studying pride and envy, I found two things that I just thought were interesting and helpful to me in rethinking this kind of sin issue. The first is just kind of an interesting thing to consider is that we tend to only compare ourselves to people in our life stage, around our own age. People who we view to be equals in age and life season. So men and women are rarely jealous of each other because it's like, well, she's a girl, so I'm not going to be jealous of the path she's taking because that's like her thing because she's a woman and like it's a different experience and whatever. But like if a guy has something that, some opportunity that you think you should have as guys, it's like, what? Oh. We're the same age and we're the same gender, so we should probably have access to the same opportunities. And so, wait, I'm sorry, what? I should have that. And so it's, you know, like I think you don't look at a guy who's older than you driving a sweet car and think, what? I should have that car. He shouldn't. No, you're like, okay, that's something to strive toward. You're inspired by that. But if it's a peer, you're like, what? Should be my car. So we compare to people in our life stage because we find that we believe that should be accessible to us if it's accessible to them. So that's where some pride and envy kind of comes in. And I think that, so that's the first thing, is just, it should be that we're just fascinating. But the second thing is to me, it's very clear that pride is at the root of all of these things. If we look at someone and say, because the comparison game, we can win or lose in a comparison. We can look at someone else and be like, well, my abs are ripped and theirs aren't, so I guess I worked a little harder. I win. Because, like, I've done the thing. And so you can, it's like, oh, and that's pride. When you win a comparison, you're like, that's pride. When you lose in a comparison, you're like, well, these abs are ripped and mine aren't ripped. Well, I should be ripped. It's like, people that say ripped. Rick is in! Rick is in! I am trending! Did I get that wrong? Oh gosh. Anyways, if you compare and you lose the comparison, then it comes from a place of like, well, how come he can afford a gym membership and I can't? Well, that's not fair. And, oh, well, he must have more time. Well, it's because his parents are rich. He doesn't have to work as hard as I do and everything. And all of a sudden, it's like, that's also pride. Because if you lose in this comparison trap, and you discover, like, oh, I'm not as good as the other person in this comparison, Well, that your that sense of being disgruntled is from a place of prideful entitlement. You want what other people have. You want, it's like, well, he's a great, well, it's because he, I don't have that. Well, I should, for some reason, have it. Pride. That's all pride. And so to me, the root of, I believe, most sin, but especially jealousy and envy, is truly pride. And we see that as early as Proverbs, Genesis 3:5 in the garden. We see, like, yeah.
It says, for God knows that when you eat of the eyes, you'll be opened, and you will be like God, knowing good from evil. Knowing good from evil.
Yeah. And why was that enticing? Like, I read that, and I'm like, what? Like, why? They're going to bring sin, the sin condition upon all of mankind because they want to know good and evil? But it really makes sense because really the desire there, it's a prideful desire to be like God. And like, if someone said to me, you can know it all, I'm like, oh yeah, I already know it all, girl. So that is where I want to arrive. And so that's a temptation to be like God. That's pride. That's like the original sin is comparison. They were comparing themselves to God and they were like, oh, he has something I don't have. He knows something I don't know. I want to be like God. That is like entitlement and pride at its worst.
So we have about 7 minutes left.
Okay.
So we've talked about what jealousy is, mm-hmm. things to help, what to do when they creep in. How do we learn to like really uproot this though?
Yeah.
It's fine to like do sin management, but
yep.
how do we
yeah.
deal
so,
with the issue?
Yep, so we want to learn from it, but then we want to also like stop. We need to like stop that pattern. And so once we've kind of started to get in the habit of kind of dissecting what is this indicating in my life, I think my little phrase I like to use, I use this with my kids, but I also use this in speaking events because I think it's an easy thing to remember is stop, say, walk away. With any sin, you can use this. You need to stop it immediately. Don't dabble. Don't see how far you can go. Just stop. Stop, say, and walk away. So stop is just like, don't stop comparing yourself. As soon as you catch yourself doing it, stop it. Say it out loud to an accountability partner, to a small group, to somebody here, to someone who can understand, a pastor, a friend, somebody who can help hold you accountable. But also, more importantly, say it out loud to God. Confess it. Ask for his forgiveness and ask for his help in moving forward. So stop, say, and then walk away. Now, you really should be runaway, like panic and scramble away, because if you're thinking about that people mover that's always moving you in the direction of sin, it has to be more than walk away, because if you're just stopping, you're still going to move forward towards sin. So you have to stop, say, and then you need to like hightail it out of there like your life depends on it, because it actually does. So that's the first thing. Stop, say, walk away. And then I think there are three biblical antidotes that that might help with this. So I don't know if you want to go into these verses, but we don't have much time. So
what else one?
You do? Okay. Okay, so go ahead and read it.
1 Thessalonians 5:16-18. Be joyful always, pray continually, give thanks in all circumstances, for this is God's will for you in Christ Jesus.
Yeah. So that's just like giving thanks in all circumstances. It is hard for envy to survive in a heart that is drenched in gratitude. If we focus on the things that we have to be grateful for, we will not be as discontent. It's just impossible. A heart that is filled with gratitude, that is rejoicing always, will be content. But if you're focusing on that thing you don't, that 5% that you don't have, or that one opportunity you didn't get, or the thing that you can't afford, you will always be discontent. But if we're a heart that is drenched in gratitude, those roots of envy cannot grow deep. So the next one, 1 Timothy 6:6-7.
But godliness with contentment is great gain, for we brought nothing into the world and we can take nothing out of it.
So to me, when I first look at those verses, they don't seem related. Godliness and contentment, and then we can't bring anything out of the world. And it's like, actually, that makes so much sense. We will be content when we are focused on eternal things. When all of our attention and affection and emotions and money and talent and time, when all of those things are being directed toward God first, we will understand our worth and our value and we will be content in our life. And when that takes place, we will have this understanding that we lack nothing of spiritual importance. And when we are aware of that, then we have this eternal perspective. And so it's much easier to be content when you're thinking, suffering is temporary, these things I don't have, I can't bring them with me anyways, and my path is my path, and I don't have to compare to somebody else's. And so kind of having that eternal perspective. And then the last one is, I'll actually read this one because this kind of unpacks sort of the whole thing. So I always feel like this is a little cheesy to get into the First Corinthians when you're talking about love, because it's at every wedding ever. But I think this is how we should love each other. This isn't just romantic love. This is like how we should love just people in our lives. And so it's 1 Corinthians 13:4-7. It says, love is patient, love is kind, it does not envy. So that's the first part, is it doesn't envy. We won't do it. When we are in perfect love, when we realize how perfectly loved we are by God, we can perfectly love other people, and there won't be room for envy. So when we're focusing on that, there's no envy. It does not boast. Joseph, totally. Popping the collar, selfie with the jacket. No, won't do that. It is not proud. It talks about that, the pride. To me, this is all connected. When I read this verse, I was like, oh, this is all about this. So there is no room for pride. It is not rude. It is not self-seeking. It is not easily angered. It keeps no record of wrongs, which we will see in a minute when I wrap up the Joseph story. You'll see this no record of wrongs. Love does not delight in evil. That's that damaged joy, delighting in evil and destruction. Does not delight in evil, but rejoices with the truth. It always protects, always trusts, always hopes, always perseveres. Love never fails. I mean, take out the cheesy wedding readings aside, those verses are the bomb diggities. And I don't care if nobody says that anymore, because those verses truly are the beasties. Okay.
Is
that too far?
Down.
Am I getting worse? I felt like I was getting better, but no, okay. My bad. Okay. So that's that. The end, just like, as I was preparing for that talk I did at my church about this, I reread the story of Joseph. Do you have that?
Yeah.
Okay. So, is it 45? Okay, yes, when Joseph makes himself known, this is in Genesis 45, he makes himself known. So basically what happened with Joseph is the brothers were jealous, they did the slavery thing, and then he was, he finds himself in Egypt. And Joseph kind of realizes why God brought him there, because what happened was Joseph, while in prison, was able to kind of, he would have this ability to interpret dreams. And so God allowed Joseph to be the mechanism that saved an entire people group. There was a famine that was coming, and Joseph interpreted this dream knowing that a famine was going to come. And so he warned Pharaoh and let him know that, okay, we've got to like stockpile some resources here or everybody's going to starve to death. And that allowed that, like, that his ability to interpret the dream really made him the highest ranking official in Egypt, just below Pharaoh. Nobody had more power in all of Egypt than Joseph. And Joseph's brothers and family and father and, you know, everybody was starving because they were not in Egypt. And so they came to Egypt and approached, humbly looking for food and resources. And Joseph reveals himself to his brothers after multiple interactions. You should read the story. It's very riveting. But the culmination point here is, Joseph makes himself known to his brothers. It says, and now, and this is Joseph speaking to his brothers who have been kind of the catalyst for him ending up in like some horrible circumstances, but ultimately God redeemed it for good. So he says, and now do not be distressed and do not be angry with yourselves for selling me here, because it was to save lives that God sent me ahead of you. For 2 years now, there has been famine in the land, and for the next 5 years, there will not be plowing or reaping. But God sent me ahead of you to preserve for you a remnant on earth and to save lives by a great deliverance. So then, it was not you who sent me here, but God. He made me father to Pharaoh, lord of the entire household, and ruler of all Egypt. So to me, this is like a really beautiful kind of culmination of this story where you see Joseph not keeping record of wrongs, but freeing them and forgiving them, because ultimately he saw that like the deeper story behind his suffering and his lack. You know, he could have been discontent through all those circumstances, and he could have held a grudge. But even though like the early chapters of his story and the early chapters of our story have included comparison and jealousy and envy, we can come to a place of spiritual maturity where we can recognize that there's a bigger purpose and a deeper story for each of us that doesn't include this discontentment, this jealousy, and this envy any longer. Because our goal and the purpose of our life is to glorify and worship God.